بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والجنة للموحدين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين الصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في محكم التنزيل بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He shower His choicest of peace and blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, His family, His companions, and upon all those who tread His path in the day of Qiyamah. Respected brothers and elders in Islam, when we take the life of a human being, his life is full of experiences which he undergoes during his process of development. Till he goes to the grave, every human being experiences something in life. At times it is happiness, at times it is sadness. Sometimes it is prosperity, sometimes it is poverty. So there are different phases, different situations and times which every human being faces in his life. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has guided us to a certain amal, to a certain deed. If we are to practice that, we will be able to face the difficulties, the worries, the anxieties, the sorrows in our life in a very easy way, accepting the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That deed, respected brothers, is a dua. The word dua in Arabic means to call or to invoke, supplication. This is the literal meaning of the word dua or da'a. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when mentioning with regard to this in the Holy Quran, He says, وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ اُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبُ لَكُمْ Your Lord said, O insan, call me, I am ready to respond to your call. Or invoke me, I am ready to respond to your call. Thereafter Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِلِينَ سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِلِينَ And thereafter He says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ And those who are too proud to invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَيَدْخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ دَاخِلِينَ They soon shall enter Jahannam in a disgraceful manner. Scholars of tafsir have explained what is the meaning of the word yastakbirun. What is the meaning of the word proud? So respected brothers, to make it easy, to simplify it, when we take the classes of people, we can divide them into three. When it comes to invoking Allah. Number one, he's a person who is regular. It is his habit that he makes dua in his life. He makes it a point that he never misses it. He remembers Allah during times of adversity, difficulty. So he calls Allah and he gets the help of Allah. This is the first type of person. The second type is a man who invokes Allah at the time of difficulty. At the time of difficulty. He's facing some hardship, so he needs support. So he invokes Allah, he prays to Allah so that Allah would help him to get rid of this problem. And the third type of person is such, a person who confronts difficulty in life, but yet he is not prepared to invoke Allah. He is proud. He thinks that he can handle the whole problem. He can find solution with his talent, with his wealth. He feels low. He demeans the act of dua. He says, why do I need to call Allah? I can solve it. So this verse, the word yastakbirun, proud, refers to the third class of people. Not to the second class, where he invokes Allah at the time of difficulty. Whereas it is that man who doesn't even bother or think of calling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at times of difficulty. So therefore, respected brothers and elders in Islam, dua is an amal which was practiced by the Anbiya alayhi salatu wassalam. When we take the list of the prophets mentioned in the Quran, we see all of them made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when we take the command in this verse, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ud'uni astajib lakum. O mankind, invoke, call me, I am ready to respond. So is the mukhatab here, those addressed here are the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whereas when you take the previous nations, if anybody had something, they wanted to solve a problem, they used to approach the Prophet and they used to tell, O Prophet of Allah, we are facing this difficulty, pray to Allah so that He would find us an out, so that we can find some exit from this problem. But whereas this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it a universal command, where any Muslim who calls Allah, Allah is ready to respond. So this is a distinguishing factor, and it is a privilege for this ummah that dua is something which has been given to the common mass, to the entire ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what are the factors which we need to offer, or what we need to observe if we want our duas to be accepted? Some of us think, I make dua, I have supplicated so much, but yet I don't get a response from Allah. It crosses our mind at times. But respected brothers, when we take the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see, there are certain deeds which he has prescribed. If we are to adhere to them, inshallah, we will be those men. If we are to raise our hands, Allah will accept our duas. Number one, it is to be dutiful to our parents. We need to look after them. We need to care them. Whatever age they are, we need to love them. We have to be gentle with them. The moment a person does this act, he becomes a person who gets that card, where he has the privilege card of getting his duas accepted. Scholars write an example for this. During Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's time, there was a man whose name was Uwais ibn Amir, who is well known to most of us as Uwais al-Qarani. This man, who was living in Yemen, later came to Medina. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned to his companions with regard to this man. After giving his brief description, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Umar radiallahu anhu, this man Uwais ibn Amir will be coming to meet you all someday. When he comes to you, ask him to seek forgiveness for your sins. This command was given to Umar radiallahu anhu. This riwayat is in Bukhari and Muslim. And we see Umar radiallahu anhu, during his khilafat, he comes across this man Uwais ibn Amir. And in that hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the special thing this man used to do, Kana, he used to look after his parents. He was dutiful to his parents. So go to that man. If he comes to meet you, ask him to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your sins. And Umar radiallahu anhu did as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded him to do. Based on this hadith, scholars say, if a person is dutiful to his parents, this person's du'as will be readily accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another amal which we could do, before we supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we could perform a good deed. For an example, we could perform salah, give out sadaqah, fasting. By this we get closer to Allah, and once we get closer to Him, we will be able to raise our hands and ask for whatever we need. This is a recommended act which scholars have specified. And number three, respected brothers, our hearts should be attentive while we make dua. Our hearts should be attentive while we make dua. For an example, if we are to meet a person to get one of our needs fulfilled, it is easy for us to converse with him, to make him understand, because he's in front of us, we can see him, we see that he's listening to us, so we know to put our issues forward in the correct way. And our discussion, it is wholeheartedly we are concentrating with him. But whereas when it comes to dua, we communicate with a being who is not in front of us, who is in the unseen, who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So generally, due to our weakness, when we make dua to Allah, our concentration most of the time goes to different directions. Maybe we start off with good intentions. At times we will be concentrating. No sooner a few minutes pass, we are not concentrating in our dua. Some of us at times we pray to Allah. Once the dua is over, we don't know what dua have we asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Udu'u Allah wa antum muqinoon. Call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a state that you have firm conviction that Allah will respond to your call. And thereafter he said, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَجِبُ دُعَاءً مِنْ قَلْبٍ غَافِلٍ لَاهِنْ. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept the dua of a person whose heart is heedless, is not concentrating, his heart is occupied with some play or amusement or something else. So if a person's heart is occupied in such a thing, then his dua will not be accepted. Because respected brothers, in dua we are addressing the King of all kings. And in his presence, if we are not ready to focus ourselves in our dua, it is obvious that duas will not be accepted. And also scholars prescribe, it is recommended, or it is a sunnah in fact, to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to send salutations on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before we ask for dua. One day Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in the masjid, a man enters and he says, اغفر لي وارحمني. Ya Allah, اغفر لي وارحمني. Oh Allah, forgive me and shower your mercy on me. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hears this dua and he says, oh man, if you are to ask dua, first praise Allah, then send salutations on me, and then ask for your needs. No sooner he said this, another man enters the masjid and he did as Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prescribed. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard this, he said, you can ask for whatever you want, Allah is ready to accept your dua. So we need to praise Allah and then send salutations on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for something. Which type of du'as are the best? Is a question which most of us will have. When we take the Quran and the Hadith, we see that there is something special in those du'as compared to the du'as which we make or compose. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam liked du'as which was comprehensive, which was short, and which had a very deeper meaning. It is mentioned in Muslim. And when we take the du'as which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to frequently recite, one was, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. The dua which most of us have memorized. The meaning of this dua is, O Allah, give us the good in this world and give us the good in the hereafter and save us from the torments of hellfire. So we ask Allah to give us the good in this world, so the worldly life is covered, and thereafter we ask about the hereafter, and finally we ask for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from hellfire. So within these three du'as, the man's complete life is included. Subhanallah. So whereas when we take the du'as of Quran, Hadith, we find it. But when we take our du'as, most of the time, we are narrow-minded when we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't think broadly. At times we are very stingy. Allah is ready to give us, but we are not ready to ask from Him. At times we think, okay, I'm suffering a loss in my business, or my parents are sick. Our du'as are restricted to the sickness of so-and-so or such-such person. We don't go beyond that. But whereas when we take the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam du'a or the du'as in the Quran, it is far more broader, and those meanings could be written pages and pages. Let us take the example of the du'as which Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa sallam mentioned. He says, رَبَّنَا حَبْلَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنْ وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. There are so many du'as in the Quran which Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa sallam made. All these du'as, if we are to look at it very closely, we would see that these du'as are more than enough to solve all our problems in life. Subhanallah. So respected brothers, take time, find the du'as which are mentioned in the Quran and Hadith and try to bring them in practice. So that we would spend little time, and our investment, even though it is small, the returns will be great. Our returns are going to be great. And one of the most important things which we need to see is, what prevents our du'as from being accepted? What prevents our du'as from being accepted? There are many, out of which two are very important. Number one, we are impatient. We want the response from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately. Some of us get tired of making dua. Some of us think, why isn't Allah responding to my dua? We start posing questions. At times it starts disturbing our aqidah as well. This is wrong. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, La yazalu yustajabu lil abdi ma lam yada' bi ismin aw qati'ati rahmin ma lam yasta'jil. As long as A person does not pray to Allah asking for sins or to sever the family ties, or as long as he is not rushing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would accept his dua. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum asked him, Mal istijar, what is the meaning of hastening or rushing or hurrying, Ya Rasulullah? He said, a man would say, Qad da'awtu wa qad da'awtu, I called Allah, I invoked Allah, falam ara yastajibu li, I don't see that he is responding to my call. I called him and I called him, he's not responding anymore. فَيَسْتَسْهِرُ عِنْدَ ذَٰلِكَ وَيَدَعُ الدُّعَى. So he gets tired of dua and he leaves dua. Whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had kept something good for him in store, but this man was impatient, so Allah is not going to accept that person's dua. So number one, we need to be patient and we have to be positive. We mustn't be pessimistic. Will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept this dua? In a hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I behave with the slave of Adam the way he considers me to be. So if we think, will Allah help me? If our hearts are doubting that Allah will help us, the probability of that dua being accepted is very, very less. Whereas a person does dua with firm conviction that Allah will surely help me, then Allah is ready to help him. When you look at the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, after he left his wife and his son, in the midst of the desert where there wasn't anyone, he called Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What was the dua he made? Ya Allah, turn the attention of the human beings towards that land. Our akal, our intellect would say, I'm making this dua after leaving my family somewhere where there is no human interaction. How will this dua be accepted? Is a question. But Ibrahim alayhi salam was firmly convicted that he had firm conviction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will surely accept this dua. And we see millions of people gather even today. Subhanallah. So we need that firm conviction which Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam had when we call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our needs. And reason number two why our duas go unanswered is what we eat, the food we take, or the income we have. Most of us, the moment we think of food, whether it is halal or haram, we always focus on a logo. That is one part. But we need to see whether income is halal or not. If the income is halal, you buy a product which is halal, it doesn't matter that what you consume is considered to be haram. If the income is haram and you buy something halal, then whatever you consume is considered haram. So we need to see that our income is pure, free from haram. We don't cheat anyone, we don't deceive anyone, we live up to our words. If we are such in our trade and our business, then what we consume will be turning out to be halal and our duas will be accepted. This is proven by the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, a man who travels a long journey, and after that, and Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam describes about this man. This man have traveled far, his hair is unkept, he is covered in dust, and now he spreads his hand out praising Allah. He's praising Allah, Ya Rab, Ya Rab. And he's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help him on something. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this person's drink is haram, what he eats is haram, he's nourished in haram, how is it possible that this person's dua will be accepted? In another hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the traveler's dua is readily accepted without any barrier in the court of Allah. But this man, in spite of being one of those liable to receive the help of Allah, because of his haram consumption of food, drink and clothing, Allah is not prepared to accept this dua. So therefore, respected brothers, we need to make our incomes pure and what we eat pure, so that our duas will be accepted in the court of Allah. And finally, what could we do to bring this dua as a practice in our life? Number one, at least every day we need to spend some time invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Most of us would say, when I pray, I ask Allah to guide me. I read the verse, Ihdina sirat al-mustaqim. I ask Allah to guide me. Yes, true. But apart from salah, we need to take separate times to invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our difficulties and troubles. Okay, what if a man is living a peaceful life, he hasn't even tasted difficulty in life? Does he need to ask Allah for something? Yes, all of us are in need. What is it? We need to ask Allah to give us Firdaus. There wouldn't be a single human on the face of this earth who would say that I have never tasted a difficulty in life. But if there is someone who says that, but yet he has to invoke Allah, asking him, Ya Allah, grant me Jannah, save me from hell. Subhanallah. So all of us are in need of dua. So we need to allocate certain timings so that we will become close to Allah and our duas will be accepted. And number two, we need to teach our little ones about the importance of dua. It is saddening to see that when our little ones, some of the little ones see, when an elderly man cried, invoking Allah, and this small boy starts laughing. He doesn't know that when you make dua, when you start crying for your sins, it is a personal relationship a man has with his Lord. But this young man sees that man crying. He says, why does he need to cry? Subhanallah. Crying has become specific for the seniors, the elders in the community. Youngsters don't have tears in their eyes anymore. How many of us have spent nights where everybody is asleep and the personal conversation, the munajat with Allah has made our tears roll down our cheeks? How many of us, respected brothers? When you take Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba, it was weird for them to be without tears. In the gathering of Nabi, if Sahaba didn't cry, they used to find it they were guilty of it. When the whole majlis cries, one man remains silent without crying, they felt it bad. So if a person has the real connection, the moment he starts conversing with Allah, he finds that taste, and that taste cannot be described with words. That is the individual taste that he enjoys with Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us that. And there are certain du'as we need to teach our little ones, which they have to read for us. For an example, the du'a which is read after the third takbir in Salatul Janaza. How many of us? It's a du'a for the mayyit. It is a du'a we memorize while we are living, but which we are not going to read at the time of our janaza. Allahumma ighfir lahu warhamhu wa'afihi wa'fu anhu wa'akrim nuzulahu. This long du'a is memorized, but none of us are going to read it for our janaza. We memorized it so that we read it for some of our Muslim brothers and sisters. But the saddest part today is, respected brothers, we have educated our sons and our daughters, and so many people are educated, they have degree after degree, but that degree holder is unable to memorize a 3-line dua, subhanallah. And the father passes away and janaza is brought to the masjid. And the imam calls, is there anybody amongst the family members who is ready to conduct the salah? And most of the cases, they say, the imam of the masjid, you can proceed. But is there somebody in the family who can come forward and tie for takbir and then read that long dua for the father? So we need to bring that into our community. We need to memorize that dua and teach them to our children. And finally, when we speak to someone about the difficulties we have in life, we feel comfortable, we feel relaxed. But how far are we going to address the makhluk? Let us address the Khaliq, who is not tired of listening to us, who listens, who responds, who answers our call. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the opportunity to call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in times of difficulty, happiness, in prosperity and poverty. Wa akhir da'wayan alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.